Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. You're watching Programming with Qt and QML. We're almost done now. What we saw in the last video was how do we create models in C++ that can provide data up to the QML that we can connect to the list view. These models, if you're not careful, they can be very, very complex. So the model is able to fetch data somewhere. It's able to modify the data. It's able to filter the data. It's able to do lots and lots of things. And before you know it, you have this gigantic thing that on top of the extra burden that it needs to be a model to QML, it also needs to do a lot of other things. To the rescue, we have a concept called a proxy model. Again, the model view section in our regular on-site training is a whole day. So proxy model, I would go much more into detail in a regular on-site training than I do here. So there's a bit for you to read up, but I'll just show you two very simple proxy models and then you will have to take it from there. But trust me, I have created more proxy model than you have had peace. I know what I'm talking about. Proxy model is definitely worthwhile for your design. Look at this image that we have here on the screen. I have a model that can provide videos and songs. So what you see with the green in front of it, that's two songs, Enjoy the Silence from my beloved Depeche Mode. There is The Matrix. If you don't know that movie, what are you doing here? So we have videos and songs coming out of one model. Now imagine that I wanted this model to be connected to two different views. One view is showing you everything. The other view is only showing you the music. Now, how would you do that? Well, I'm sure that you would right away say, well, that's an easy one. I'll just add a Boolean on my model. So I'll create a method that's called set do include movies. And if it's set to false, then I'll only provide the audio. And if it sets to true, then I will provide both of them. And then inside my model, I of course need to filter out on how many it is. So there's two problems here. Problem number one, you need now two models, not one model. Well, two instances of that model. So if there's any editing, they need a backway communication so they can update each other. That's problem number one. Second problem is that now you're diluting that model with also doing some filtering. So instead, you really want to have a proxy model. The idea with the proxy model is that it will act as if it was a view on one side, and on the other side, it will act as if it's a model. Talk about being schizophrenic, huh? That proxy model sits down there and it communicates to a view above it, just as if it was a real QAbstract item model subclass. Oh wait, it is. But it also listens to the signals that comes from the model underneath it. So the real model, the real QAbstract item model subclass at the bottom will emit signals upwards, like value has changed. It will do whatever. So this proxy model will communicate like if it was a model upwards, and it will communicate as if it was a view downwards. And you can have multiple of those. You can have your real model, then one proxy model here, another proxy model there, another there, and there, and there, and there, and there. And then at the top, you have the view. That's perfectly okay. I think my record is that I got 6 or 7 proxy models stacked on top of each other. And the beautiful about that design is that my proxy model, each of them does only a very little thing. It's very easy to validate whether they do the right thing. And even better, I can take one of those proxy models and just put it in a different context and use it there again. So what does it look like in code? Well, first of all, somewhere deep down, we instantiate our real model. That is a model that connects to the data that you want to show upwards. Now you can create another model that sits on top of that. So you create that model first. So in this example, it's a Q sort filter proxy model. That's a long name. So the Q sort filter proxy model is sitting on top of the model. And the way that it sits on top is that to my Q sort filter proxy model, I tell it set source model and I give it the model below it. And had I had multiple of those models, I would have created another, say, Q sort filter proxy model, And I would ask that one to say, I would say set source model giving it this proxy here. And I could do that to whatever extent I wanted. Now, in this example that we have over here, where I have two different views on the same data, I would, of course, need to export both of those to the QML level. So go to my root context here, set context property, and simply CPP model, export that one, and the CPP proxy model, export that one. You can do a lot of things with proxy models. You can sort your data underneath. You can filter the data underneath. For that, we actually have Qsort filter proxy model. You can modify just the data without actually modifying the structure of the data. So sorting and filtering, you're gonna throw away some rows, or you're gonna change the order of the rows. But you can also simply modify the individual elements. And the typical, the classroom example of that is if you had a model that provided numbers, then it could change the color of the numbers to be red if they were negative. Of course, you could have done that already in your model underneath, or you could do it in the view up there at the top. But you could also let just a proxy model sit in there and highlight negative numbers in red. It could add some decoration to them. So if it was a model that provided financial data, then you could add euro signs as part of going through that proxy model. You can see here on the screen, there is a lot of examples of what you can do with proxy models. And let's not go into too much detail on each of those. Let me just give you one link though. There is this, if you Google for K item models, that's a KDE framework library that has, I think, 10 different proxy models that you can take right out of the box and use. Some of them are more for tree models, and if you have the need for tree models in your class, you'll be very happy about them. But there are some of them that also can just be used with regular list models. So when you want to create your own models, when you want to create a proxy model, you have a few options here. You can go and subclass from QAbstract proxy model. As you can hear from the name, it's abstract. The QAbstract proxy model, among other things, there you need to be concerned about how do I map my model indexes from what the view talks about to what the row to the model underneath me talks about. That is, let me just say that up front, very complex. Fortunately, I think I've subclassed from QAbstract proxy model like 3 or 4 times in my career. Most of the time, you will actually be able to use either the QIdentity proxy model, which again, it's the one that doesn't change the structure of your data, or you can use out of the box the Qsort filter proxy model. I will show you the identity proxy model in use in this video here. In the next video, it's going to be an example of a Qsort filter proxy model. So let's jump right to it. So the Qidentity proxy model looks like this. These are the methods that you usually would override. So you would change the data with the data method. You could possibly change how the set data is done. So the view sets the data, you modify that somehow, and you set it on the model underneath. Header data, we don't use that, at least on QList view, but you could have other views that actually had the header data and again set header data. And then there is this flags method. We shortly talked about the flags method in the previous video, but what the flags method does is that it can tell you, can this item be editable on a per item element, and can it be selected, and so on. Some of these things doesn't make all that much sense if you use a list view in QML. They are more specific for, say, if you use a QList view in a widget setup. So now you know what it does, and also have the warning that not all of it makes sense in a QML setup. Let me just show you a solution to a lab. So had this been a scheduled training or an on-site training, I would ask my students to go back and try and implement one of those models. And I would have given them a bit more hints up front here. But let me just show you the solution to this lab here that gives us an example of a simple Q identity, whatever model. These names are terrible to remember. Let me run this example here. I have a model. That's what you see here on the left side. The model just returns me those songs here and who is the band and how long is the song. And then I want another version. That's the proxy. That's the result of the proxy model that we see over here, where the names of the songs are capitalized and all the other stuff is as before. I got my playlist model. It looks like this. So here's my playlist model. That is the one that actually contain the real data. The real data is stored in a Q vector of entries here. So here's my data. Let me stress out again. This is not about models anymore, but it's worthwhile to stress out yet another time. Your data usually do not necessarily, or they are usually not necessarily stored in the model themselves. It could be satellite flying around. It could be sensors. It could be whatever that you then go and ask for the real data when you need it. But that's, again, I just want to stress it out. I have a row count, and actually you'll notice that this model here is look exactly like what we did in the previous video, so let's not bother too much about that anymore. And then I got this all uppercase proxy model. My all uppercase proxy model, subclass from QIdentity proxy model, it overrides this method called data. And well, that's it. So what my all uppercase proxy model does is that it'll go and ask the data method here. It'll go and ask the data for the superclass of it. So the view goes to the all uppercase proxy model and it asks it, can you please give me the data for row number two, whatever. Now, what it does is that it goes and say, yes, I can do that. I actually need to go to my model underneath, but rather than communicate straight to the model underneath, it just says, well, it's a QIdentity proxy model, so I just ask my superclass, and the superclass will go and just get the data straight from the model underneath. I could have gone and asked the model underneath. That would have been just fine and just the same. So now I have a Q variant that is the value that the model underneath gave me. I will check whether the role we are looking for is actually the title role, because remember, the only thing we want to do is uppercase the title. If it's a title role, then I will take my value here and I will convert it into a string. And if you don't know what is going on here, you likely missed a video on Q variants. I'll convert it into a string here and I will call a method on the string called toUpper that makes it all uppercase, and I'll return that. Of course, if that was not the code path that I took, if I was not looking for the role for the title, I should, of course, just return what the model underneath gave me. So I'm just changing those little bit of pieces of information that I want. See, I got 30 lines of code here, of which most of it is, well, for a start, we got 9 lines of header data or copyright data on it. So we are down to less than 20 lines of code. We are down to just these from 21 to 28, 7 lines of code that is really complex, that is doing what we really want to do. Let me put it this way. 7 lines of code that now does that. I can take that proxy model, and I can create another very simple proxy model, the proxy model that will change the seconds into minutes so that it doesn't say 316 seconds, but says 6 minutes and 16 seconds instead. I put that one here and that one there, and I could have all these proxy models standing on top of each other, each of them being very simple, each of them being very simple to debug if there should be a bug. That was the first proxy model that I wanted to show you. And I hope that I got your energy running here and saying, this looks like something that's interesting. I'll show you 2 more videos before we're done here. In the next video, I'm going to show you the Q sort filter proxy model, how you work with those. I'll both be sorting and filtering. And in the very final video, now that's going to be a surprise. Until then, have a great time.